It's 4 o'clock on a Monday, and you know what that means, don't you? It's time for another exciting episode of Taxi TV Live. Woohoo! I am really excited to have today's guest, Mr. Bobby Borg, with us. Hey, Bobby, how are you?
Hey, Michael, how are you today? Thanks for having me.
My pleasure. Love having you. Bobby is a very popular presence at the Road Rally and on Taxi TV. He's got a new book out, which I'll talk about in a second, or a revised version, a third edition of one of his classics. It says Bobby Borg MCM, Masters in Communications and Marketing. Is that what that MCM stands for?
Yeah, Masters in Communication Management from USC. It's you know, essentially marketing and conflict management and persuasive speaking, just all kinds of stuff like that.
You can do all that.
It's all interesting stuff.
But the interesting thing about Bobby is he's one of you guys. He's a former major label, independent DIY recording and touring artist. He's an adjunct lecturer at University of Southern California's Thornton School of Music and Annenberg School of Communications and Journalism. He's a founder of Bobby Borg Consulting, the author of The Musician's Handbook, Music Marketing for the DIY Musician, Business Basics for Musicians, Introduction to Music Publishing for Musicians, and Personal Finance for Musicians. I've got to tell you, Bobby, the finance thing, I didn't think that topic would be so loved by our audience. Musicians, it's like, yeah, I can't even balance a checkbook. You know, I don't watch my money. I'm like, that video, when we cut it up and made shorts, has gotten a lot of attention. So good job on that. Yeah.
Good deal. Excellent.
Here, I was going to hold up the book, but look, I can do this fancy thing. So we've got the third edition of Business Basics for Musicians, and it's the complete handbook from DIY to the majors. Bobby's books are so unbelievably packed with critical information. And you might look at it and go, wow, that's a pretty thick book. That's a lot of reading. But you know what? I actually have read almost every page of almost every book that Bobby has given me over many, many years. These books aren't something that you have to read cover to cover. You don't start at the beginning and work your way to the end, unless maybe you're using it in a course you're taking or something. What it's great for is that day where you've got to do band contracts and you need some high-level advice on that. Look up band contracts. So it's a resource more than a linear thing, unless you were taking a course and needed it for that.
Right. That is true.
Yeah, today.
Yeah, it's written so that you could basically, if you had a subject that you wanted to discuss, you could just open it to that page and pretty much start reading. Or if you prefer, you can give it the old, cover to cover read. So it's really what everybody, it's for anyone, whatever you want to do.
Well, it's loaded with information, as are all your books. And I'll tell you what, if you ever get a chance to see Bobby and Michael Ames together talking publishing at the Road Rally, or even go back to an episode we did on Taxi TV with them, you just sit there going, wow, there's so much to know, and these guys are so clear in the way they explain it. So that's why I invited Bobby on the show today to talk about music publishing for sync music creators specifically. We may veer a little left or right of that, but there are some different things when it comes to sync. And lately I've been on a real tear. There are a lot of myths out there amongst musicians that have been propagated over decades of musicians being pissed off at the major labels, feeling like everybody in the industry wants to rip them off. And I think that a lot of people are stuck in a major label mindset when they need to shift their mindset when they start doing music for sync, because it's a different animal. So that's what we're going to talk about. So let's start, because I'm assuming that not everybody who's watching today's show has seen you on Taxi TV before or taken one of your classes at the rally. So for those who are new to songwriting, those who are new to creating music for sync, can you give kind of a publishing 101 course about all of it, if it takes you 15 minutes to a half an hour to go through it, it'd be time well spent. So knock us out.
Sure, absolutely. So I think one of the first things that people need to understand is what music publishing means. Like, what's the definition of music publishing? And then particularly, like, what do copyrights have to do with it? Simply because when you hear music publishing, you usually hear copyrights. When you hear copyrights, you usually hear about music publishing. So let's define it. So music publishing, simply put, is the business of songs. It has everything to do with the plugging of your song, the licensing of your song, the collecting the generated incomes from your song, and even maybe policing the song to make sure that if, you know, anyone is infringing it, they're dealt with accordingly. So it has to do with all of those things. Now, how does copyrights come into the picture? Well, copyrights are the legal rights that constitute protection of your songs. So you have music publishing to make your music available for commercial sale to the public. It's the business of songs. And then copyrights are the legal rights that constitute protection of those songs. Another way to look at it is the noun verb definition. So a lot of times when you talk about music publishing, the verb would be to publish, to make your music available for commercial sale to the public. That's what publishing is. But then you also hear it referred to as a noun, where people go, how are we going to split the music publishing, or don't sell your music publishing? And when you're talking about that, you're typically talking about the ownership rights in the songs and the copyrights. So that's another way that you can look at it. But however you see it, they're both obviously interrelated. Okay, now, so how do you get one of these beautiful babies? How do you get a copyright? So the way you get a copyright is by taking an original idea from your head and putting it into some sort of fixed or tangible form, such as lyrics on a sheet of paper, or it could be your voice on an iPhone, voice memo, or it could be obviously a song idea in your computer on your Logic or Ableton or whatever the case might be. The defining characteristic that's important these days, though, is it's a human being taking an original idea from their head and putting it into a tangible form, because now we have the issue of artificial intelligence. And currently, the Copyright Office is not seeing anything created by an artificial intelligence as being a copyright. So now this is probably going to, you know, we have a lot of work to do in this particular area. But again, when a human being takes an original idea from their head, puts it into a tangible form, a copyright is born. And that gives you what's called an exclusive bundle of rights under Section 106 of the United States Copyright Act. And I refer to those as CDPDs, just for memorization purposes, right? So C stands for copy, D stands for distribute, P stands for public performance, and 4 stands for derivative work, and also display, but it's maybe not applicable in in music, but nonetheless. So that means you have the rights to authorize or authorize others to actually copy or reproduce your music. Or you have the rights to authorize or authorize others to distribute music. You have the rights to authorize or authorize others to publicly perform your compositions. And you have the rights to authorize or authorize others to create a derivative work. And if you're not clear what those things are, reproduction would be if someone takes your song and puts it on a record, vinyl, or CD, let's just say, for example. Or if someone wants to distribute your song, make it available for commercial sale to the public. Or if anyone wants to publicly perform it, like broadcast it on the radio or on television, obviously they need your authorization or somebody else to authorize it. And a derivative is when you take a piece of your work to create another work. And that does include samples and interpolations as well. So someone would need the rights from you, obviously, if they wanted to do that. Okay, so now you should know quite a lot about music publishing already. So what are some of the exceptions to this exclusive bundle of rights? That would be, number one, a work made for hire. That is a situation that typically does exist in the film and TV world, where you are either asked to compose something under employment, or you're commissioned to compose something specifically under a work made for hire agreement. So it will say, this is a work made for hire. We are paying you $500 or $5,000 or $50,000 or $500,000 to compose something, but then we're going to own the CDPDs. So you will get credit, obviously, for writing it. We may or may not announce that, but nonetheless, you will get credit for writing it. You may, in some cases, get the public performance money, but essentially, they're going to own it. So you're working for hire. And a lot of times people look at that as being evil, but it's just basically, you know, I get asked to do work for higher stuff all the time. Someone, a university might ask me to write a syllabus. They pay me, I write a syllabus. It's not that big a problem and they own it. And I don't care because I can pump these out left and right. Just like you guys can pump out these little cues and stuff left and right, you know? I think the issue becomes when you write like that baby, like this is my hit song. This is right. like my song. And you do that under a work made for hire without knowing it maybe or not understanding it. That's where the big problem comes. Another exception for the exclusive bundle of rights is what's called the compulsory licensing provision for phonograph records. And basically what that means is that as soon as you release your song and make it available to the public, everybody else can take that song and they can put it on their record as long as they do not substantially change the lyrics or the melody. So what we're talking about here, you guys, is cover songs. So as soon as you release something, right, somebody else can take that and they can put it on their record. But note, I am stressing the word record. This is audio only. It is not audio visual. So no one can take a cover song and put it on YouTube. But you might say, but everyone does, right? And that is because of the Digital Millennium Copyright Act. There's something called the Safe Harbor Laws, basically, that say that a big corporation like YouTube can't get in trouble if that happens, but they're obligated if the publisher asks them to take it down, right? The problem is that YouTube take it down and someone puts it back up. YouTube take it down, someone else puts it up. And that's why YouTube kind of tries to make up for it by saying, sorry, we're trying. So what we're gonna do instead is if you want to let them keep it up, the ad money that runs on that, you're gonna get the majority of that, you know, and that's kind of how they try to make up for people that have stuff up there that's not licensed.
But so the copyright holder, if I do a reimagined version of a Neil Young song and I put it up there with some video that I edited together, I don't have the right to do that even though it's been released on a record. I could do a cover right. and put it on my record. Mm-hmm. But exactly. The minute I marry it to video, I'm breaking the rules and YouTube has the right to take it down. But instead, what they'll do is any ad money generated, they will send that money to Neil Young and I get to keep the music up there. So ostensibly, everybody's happy.
Yeah, I mean, that's pretty much, you know, it's like kind of fight the battles, I guess, that you can fight and win, you know. I mean, it's a game of whack-a-mole. They keep on coming up, you know. You take it down, they bring it back up again. So again, you guys, that is another one of the exceptions. All right, so let's move on real quick down the line. If what I just said was fairly easy enough to sort of understand, and if not, the great thing about Michael's videos is that you can always rewind them and watch this part again, right? But nonetheless, moving on, just to keep things simple and straightforward, what I said was simple enough for one person, now we have to consider two people, or three people, or four people, or five people, or six people, or seven people, or eight people. If you look at the Billboard charts, top 100 right now, you'll see that nearly every song in the top 10 is written by more than one person. Sometimes there's five people, six people, two people, three people. I mean, even the biggest artists like Taylor Swift is writing with people, you know? So we need to understand joint work. So what's a joint work? Well, when two or more people come together and they share melodically or lyrically in a song idea or some tangible hook, beat, or groove, a joint work is formed. So that basically means that both people jointly own those CDPDs. Now, the interesting thing about this is that if Michael writes 90% of the song and I only write 10, we both own 50, okay? Unless there's a written agreement that stipulates otherwise. Unless Michael says, hey, you know, I really wrote 90, and I go, yeah, of course, I know that, and I wrote 10. So we agree to a 90-10 split. We put together a split sheet. We tuck it away, and yes, you tuck it away. I pulled one out after 30 years.
Wow.
So, problems can arise later on. So you want to just tuck that stuff away. There are apps where you do this stuff, but you guys, the good thing about being older is that you realize that things come and go. And will an app be around 30 years from now? You know, I don't know. You know, so I always prefer the paper contracts. You stuff them away in a filing cabinet. But anyway, nonetheless, the interesting thing to understand about joint works is that you jointly own the entire song. It's not like if Michael did the lyrics and I did the music that we, you know, Michael can say, I don't like you anymore, I'm going to take my lyrics and go home. I don't like you anymore, I'm going to take my music and go home. We both jointly own the song together, and you can't pull the parts apart anymore.
So right? Even in the case of you had the song substantially finished, your producer said to you, I think it needs a bridge, Bob. And you called up your best bridge writing buddy, being me, and I come over and I write a bridge that I did most of the work. Let's call that 25% of the song's overall value. I can't separate that out and say, okay, that bridge is what I control. It's kind of like getting shares in stock. I own 25% of the stock in the whole song.
Right. Absolutely. Yeah.
Okay.
And it's difficult for people to understand that, but you're creating a joint work. I mean, there's a lot of different metaphors, if you will, some stupid, some will entirely click right away. There's the metaphor of the egg. If you take an egg, you crack an egg, you put it into a pan, and then decide, oh, I don't really feel like having this today. You can't like put the white and then the yellow back in its perspective places. It's now merged into like scrambled egg. Another funny metaphor is that two people had a baby. Still, as far as I know today, it's still male and female. You know, times are changing, but if a male and female had a baby, basically what happens when they want to get divorced? You don't say, well, you know, the eyes are mine and the nose is mine. And the wife doesn't say, well, yeah, it kind of has my chin, so I'll take the chin, you take the eyes. It's a baby. You know, and
that's a great metaphor. I've never heard this one.
You can't separate it anymore. So it's important to know that when you intend, when there's an intention for two people to come together and write a song, it is a joint work. Now, we're taught that's the percentage shares of ownership, but now how about control? Interesting thing about control is that we both control the rights to use the song, and I can use it in my album and Michael can use it in his album. But what happens if the intention of that session was to use it on my album? Hey, Michael, I'm writing an album and I need your help. Come on over, right? And then all of a sudden I write something. This is my baby hit. This is the one we've been playing in clubs. He helps me finish it. And then all of a sudden I find out that Michael released it on his record before I released it on my record. And that kind of spoils the whole purpose of it. So in the spleet sheet, you can also write how the intention of your works, how you're going to handle it in the future will be. Like, so in other words, Michael, this is the intended for the use on my record first. Or if there's any uses for the song, we all have to agree on it. Because I might not want it in a porn. I might not want it in a political campaign. I might not want it in some advertisement with some goofy product. I might not want it in a cartoon because I feel that diminishes the equity or the brand equity, right? Yeah. So we have an agreement that stipulates that we both discuss how it's going to be used. That is important, particularly because this one reason. In the United States, each party can use the song in its entirety in all non-exclusive uses, as long as they account to the other authors. So let's just say we write a song and Michael decides he wants to put it in a Taco Bell commercial, right? And Taco Bell allows Michael to license the song on behalf of everybody else. They don't want the licenses distinct from each owner, right? Michael can do that as long as he says, hey, there's this guy named Bobby Borg that exists. Right. Michael files signs a warrants and representation, and they pay Michael and then Michael pays me. That's actually allowable. Typically, Taco Bell won't want to do that. They'll want to come to me just for safety purposes. But point being about all this, you guys, when you do write a song with somebody else, you have to get a split sheet and you have to understand also the control issues, because this can backfire. And in the sync world, to kind of make sure that we stay on topic here. One of the biggest problems with sync licensing is when a TV show wants to move fast on something and there's three or four or five pain in the butt people that they have to deal with, they might decide not to deal with you at all. So,
or somebody who's disappeared, you know, a former bandmate who's a co-writer, and give no idea that the guy's living on a mountaintop in an ashram somewhere, or somebody passed away. So, yeah.
Right. They can't find them, or someone wants to be problematic. I mean, there's definitely situations where I might say, hey, I'm fine that you guys want to use this song and it's on a favored nation's basis. Everybody's going to get, you know, $200. And then the bass player's like, nope, I'm not doing it unless we get $1,000. And that blows the whole deal.
Give us a 30-second explanation of favored nations. It's something that new people may not know yet.
It's something that you see a lot in the licensing world a lot, because essentially a lot of times a song is divided among three or four writers. And then also there's a sound recording, which we'll get to in a minute, of the song, which is another copyright. So typically, to avoid, you know, like each party like negotiating and the other party wanting to know what the other party got, they just say, we're going to license everything on a favored nation's basis. That basically means everybody is getting the same thing, essentially, to really simplify it. So there is, when you see that, you know that it's like, well, what's the other guy getting? You know, there's not like this feeling like we have to negotiate and everybody's negotiating for different rates and stuff. So it kind of keeps things straight across the board and simple.
I've got a question that is on this whole topic. So normally I just let you roll, but while we're on it, we do get requests at Taxi from production music libraries or sync agents, whomever, that are looking for a reimagined cover of something. Right now, somebody's running one looking for a reimagined cover of a Fleetwood Mac song. Reimagined means you take a fast song and do a slow version. You take a male vocal, make it female, make it very ethereal. You change it up. But the song's lyric and melody are virtually identical to the original. So it's instantly recognizable, even though it's been changed in some aesthetic way. Now, that stuff, Fleetwood Mac would own, or the record company would probably own, the master recording from when that record was made. Uh-huh. Let's say Lindsey Buckingham and Stevie Nicks co-wrote the song, so they and their publisher would probably have a co-publishing deal where they own and control the publishing. So now I create the reimagined version. It's a new master recording. Nobody from Fleetwood Mac is on it. It's the Michael Lasko band. So I control half of that, and oftentimes favored nations clauses will exist in these things. But how can a small music library with an unknown artist, writer, producer that makes this reimagined cover version, how do they know that, okay, I may get a $5,000 sync fee for the master side because I created the master, and the person who gets it to Target for a TV commercial is going to negotiate a price and they're going to split the money with me. But Fleetwood Mac or Lindsey Buckingham, Stevie Nicks, and their publisher own and control the copyright on the composition. How does that library know when they put the word out, we're looking for a cover of this Fleetwood Mac song, that the original creators, Lindsey and Stevie, aren't going to say, we want $500,000 for that and queer the whole deal?
Right. So basically, when you're doing a cover song, remember, under the Compulsory Licensing Provision and Copyright Act, it's for audio only, and it's a compulsory, it's licensed under a compulsory sort of set rate. So it's not a negotiable rate. So whatever the current statutory mechanical license is, which is currently 12 point cents, right, or 12 cents, I'm entitled, compulsory is mandatory, so I'm allowed to license that. It's mandatory.
You are who?
If I'm the Michael Lasko band, in your example, that gets this offer, says, you know, or I will just do it with me to make it simple. So, hey, Bobby Borg, reimagine this song, cover this song, but reimagine it, slow it down, you know, make it, you know, whatever, but don't change the melody and lyric, make sure it falls under a cover song, right? Mm-hmm. So I'm like, okay, cool. So I'm allowed to do that, whether or not whether or not the owners of that song want me to or not. Compulsory is mandatory, so I have the rights to. And if the publisher doesn't want to give me the license, I can get the license anyway at the full statutory rate, which is currently 12 cents, right? So,
12 cents per copy, per manufacturer.
Distributed, right, yeah. Okay. So I'm allowed to do it. And of course I'm recreating the master. So I will, you know, I'll own the master of that. And as far as the licensing of the song, that's already set under the compulsory licensing provision. The problem is that if then we're going to sync that, because now, as we both talked about earlier, that becomes synchronization, mm-hmm. right? So now there's this issue of, you know, whether or not, you know, what the publisher wants in order for that to be synced, right? I mean, what do they want for that?
And that's not compulsory. They can name any price.
That's not compulsory. It's fully negotiable. So they could say, well, we want $1 million, or we want $100,000, or we want $10,000, we want $50,000 in order to do it. And then they might come to me and maybe say, well, we can't afford to pay you 50, and we can only pay you 5,000 or something on the master side, let's just say, for example. So how do I know that Fleetwood Mac isn't asking for some ridiculous amount for the actual sync part? Well, one clue is that it won't say favored nations. Right? It's not that we're not licensing this on a favored nations basis. I mean, that's obviously one clue. So I can ask, I go, well, what are they getting on their side? And I, typically speaking, it's normally done in favored nations. But if they decide that they don't want to tell me, then I guess I have to decide, do I want to continue with this? Is it a good opportunity for me? Do I care what the other side gets? You know, I'm humble, and no, I am not Fleetwood Mac, and I am not, you know, even at that level. So I'm just happy to be part of this project, you know? So I guess there would be all that rationale that would go into it as well. But you don't know, I mean, in some cases. And then you just have to decide whether or not you want to play along. You know, you could just say no, or you can make up some ridiculous amount yourself. And, you know, so there you
go. So typically I would say the Bobby Borg or Michael Lasko band is going to get $5,000 for the reimagined master version that they created. And Fleetwood Mac is going to get the $500,000. And yeah, you could be like, well, if they get $500,000, I want $500,000. But the value is they wrote a song that's known around the globe. And they could make that argument. So my advice to people, if you're ever in that situation, be reasonable. Don't hold out and make it go away because you're being unreasonable. Where your comfort level for reasonable is a whole different story.
And what you just said applies to so many things in life, right? I mean, mm-hmm. life is obviously, it's you know, I think you always have to ask, what am I giving up and what am I getting in return? And does that feel yeah. balanced to me? You know, I mean, that's essentially what it is. And you know, and also, you know, it's opportunity cost. You know, it's like I might be giving this up at like maybe, you know, a lower rate, or I could be spending my time doing something else. But look at what I'm getting in return. I'm part of this great project. So, you know, there's also the, you know, it's not always what you learn or earn, it's what you learn. So it's not always what you earn, it's what you learn. There's that, of course, too, that we have to consider.
And, you know, I've never been a huge fan of people saying, well, there's a lot of promotional value in this for you. But you know what? If you are a sync composer, producer, artist, and you have, even though it's a Fleetwood Mac song, your reimagined version is in a Target commercial, that is good on a resume, and that does give you credibility and get you indoors that you probably couldn't get in before having that.
Yeah, there's a lot of people that look at this in so many different ways. Personally, I'm with your latter thinking. You know, it's I have never had a problem paying dues, you know, and paying dues is you know, is working maybe for less pay, but for payment in experience and a chalk on your resume, you know, it does eventually matter. You just have to come to a point where you draw the line, you know, like, all right, look, I have enough experience. Now it's time to get paid, because obviously, if you never negotiate and stand up for yourself, you know, people will always try to, you know, get you for whatever they can. So, but I have never had any problems sort of just working to pay dues to build up a resume. And I think a lot of times the problems with a lot of young people coming up today is that they just expect to immediately like get paid or just like skip the rings on the ladder. And now, you know, now it's like I deserve to get this much.
Well, and neither of us are saying, in the case of this Fleetwood Mac reimagined cover, I don't think either of us are saying do it for free. We're just saying, you know, take the $5,000 because that's kind of the normal average fee that somebody in your position that has created what you have done would get. They're not saying we'll give you $50. They're saying we'll give you $5,000. But I think what we, and tell me if I'm wrong in assuming that we agree on this, we're saying don't throw a monkey wrench in the works, holding out for $500,000 because that's what Lindsey Buckingham and Stevie Nicks got. Right. What's reasonable and fair and the norm in your business for the Bobby Borg, Michael Lasko band is probably where you should draw the line, even though you might feel like, well, it ain't fair because they got $500,000 and I got $5,000.
Right.
Learn. Take the five grand.
Yeah, that's exactly what I'm saying. I mean, we all have egos in this business, but I think there's a time when you have to look in the mirror and say, well, I have not written one of the biggest selling records of all times. You know, I mean, Rumors is like, you know, it's still like up there as being, I think, one of the top 20 like records of all time.
Or I think it might be in the top 3, 4, or 5. I mean, it's way up there.
Yeah. So, we are not Fleetwood Mac, you know? So anyway, you guys get the point. But moving on, so now we talked about a number of different things, and let's move on to like, so great, we're getting it. We kind of understand what's going on here. So how long do you get, you know, to keep one of these beautiful babies, so to speak, you know? Well, currently we can go into the history of copyright sort of duration. But just to keep things simple, it's like if you wrote a song today, you get it for your full life plus another 70 years after your passing. If you write it with two people, it is the life of the last living person plus 70 years. So
really like a couple generations past you.
Well, sure. I mean, you know, because, I mean, that's a long time, you know, and, you know, if you're lucky enough to write something that stands the test of time, the good news is that when you pass on, your family will benefit from the fruits of your hard labor, you know, by virtue of a will or a trust, of course, right? Mm-hmm. Because of course, you know, we all don't know what happens on the other side, you know, and depends on your faith and your religion. But, you know, you're probably not like going to your mailbox and collecting checks, you know, or maybe you are, I don't know.
The new version of Clapton song, Tears in Heaven. This is mailbox money in heaven.
Right, exactly. But it is going to your family, which is probably reassuring to you. And, you know, what happens after it falls out of the copyright term, forms falls into the public domain, which you probably don't have to worry about with your original songs itself. You know, that just basically means that someone will now have the rights to use those materials without having to, you know, worry about paying licensing fees. But now if they create a new copyright from your work, that person now does have a new copyright and they can collect royalties from it. But I don't want to go into the weeds in that. The only place that it will probably affect most of you guys watching this is if like you decided to do like some sort of Christmas cover album or something and you wanted to use some very, very old song or something, and maybe it fell into the public domain and then you can use it and you don't have to worry about, you know, licensing and copyright issues. As long as you make sure that it's in the public domain in the US and any other country that you're going to be releasing it as well, because you don't want to have that problem. But
so what, if I may throw out a specific question. So whatever, a Christmas song, public domain, and I do a version of it, but I substantially change the lyric to make it sarcastic and comedic, and I've literally changed some lyrics, but everybody would recognize the underlying work, which is, you know, Grandma's Kissing Santa Claus or whatever, you know, mm-hmm. Something that everybody knows. Now, I have a copyright even though it comes from public domain, because I've substantially changed the lyric, I then control that, own and control the copyright on that new version.
So, yeah, I mean, if you take a public domain work, right, and then you create a new work based on that work, you're essentially creating a new copyright, and you can earn royalties on that copyright.
Interesting.
But we have to be careful to make sure that it is a public domain, you know, in first and foremost. And I think that's the danger, is a lot of people don't do enough due diligence so that they don't know whether or not for sure it's in the public domain, you know, and then that might be released in a country where the copyright laws are different, and it might be in the public domain in the US, but it might not be in Mexico, let's just say, for example. And if it's released in Mexico and someone files a claim there against you, you might have a problem. So you have to do a lot of homework, obviously.
Yeah, and there are websites that show you what's in the public domain and what isn't, but they're not 100% reliable. I have checked two or three sites and gotten different answers on a particular work. So
yeah, I mean, if you're going to be really serious about this, obviously, you know, you have to do your due diligence. I mean, I come from the school from, like, learn how to write your own stuff, you know, but definitely speak. I mean, if you're going to do this and you're going to pursue it, you have to be careful to make sure that you're not going to run into any problems. But you did kind of stress something, and you did say, if I kind of rewrote something poking political kind of review, kind of immediately some of your listeners might go, oh, is he talking about fair use? You know, so there is something in copyright law called fair use, where if you do use something, even if it's not, you know, if it's not in public domain, let's just say, and mm-hmm. you use something and you did it for political review or you did it for teaching, you know, there is something in copyright law called fair use, and it's more complicated than you think. You have to be careful about this, because a lot of people just kind of like go, oh, it's for educational reasons, fair use, or it's for, you know, we're poking. Well, let me just give you one case to show you the complexity of this. There was a group that took the song Walking Around in Winter Wonderland and redid the lyrics and said Walking Around in Women's Underwear and claimed that that was a parody. And Warner Chappell came back at them and go, show us how saying that Walking Around in Women's Underwear is poking critical review at the song itself. It's just changing the lyric and making it goofy. So you could see that this stuff gets complicated, and Warner Chappell has more money than you and can live out a lawsuit longer than you. So I would just say, just be careful about trying to play those games with, like, you know, trying to find loopholes in the copyright system, you know. So
anyway. It is the Wild West, especially on YouTube, TikTok, other forms of social media. People, you know, we'll put up a little title card that says,
put up the notices.
Yeah.
This is fair use, you know, and I'm just like going, do you really understand what that is? You know, so, but see, just be careful with that. But all right, so now we've tackled the duration issue. So now we could go on and we could talk about registration really quickly. You know, something that, you know, a lot of your writers, your readers and listeners might feel that they do have to do or they don't have to do. So let's just get down to the nit and gritty of this. So first of all, let's be clear that when you create a copyright, you're doing that through the process of writing a song. In other words, when you take an original idea from your head, a human being that is, you put it into a tangible form, a copyright already exists. So you have a copyright, right? So what is the whole purpose of registration? Because registration strengthens your CDPDs. So first of all, registration makes a public notice with the Copyright Office in Washington, D.C. that you are claiming that you're the author and owner of this song. So there's a public sort of notice there that, hey, Bobby Borg wrote this song.
And it's time-stamped. Mm-hmm. Which is going to come in handy.
Yeah, on this date and on this time. Uh-huh. Yeah. Now, there's this other three rights that are very, very important. Number one is the presumable, the right of rebuttable presumption. So the rebuttable presumption of ownership. So that basically means that if I register my song in a timely manner, anybody else that later on claims that, you know, no, that song is mine, then basically they have the burden of proof, not me. Like, you're claiming it's yours, go prove it. The burden of proof is on you.
On who?
On the person that is claiming that it's theirs.
On the original creator or the secondary creator?
the secondary creator. So just okay. to kind of clear that up, if I write a song and then I register with the copyright office, it gives me the rebuttable presumption of ownership, which basically means it doesn't automatically make it yours. It can be debated, but it's your, if you're the one that's debating it, it's your, you have to actually, burden of proof is on you, not on me. So it's presumed to be mine, but it still can be debated. So what if you're wondering like why would that would happen, because let's just say Michael writes a song right now and I'm like, oh, and I rush off and I register it. And then I come back and I go, nah, 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 nah. I own your song, right? That's ridiculous. It's like, no, you don't. I wrote the song. So just registration doesn't automatically make it yours. It could be debated, but the you registering it first is obviously an advantage. Hopefully.
What if I'm not timely in my registration? I write a song today. Tomorrow, I step onto a sailboat to do a year-long cruise around the planet Earth.
A five-year-long cruise, let's just say.
Okay, yeah, five-year-long cruise. And I still haven't registered the copyright on that song. But meanwhile, someone else
does it. Yeah.
Does. Where does that land?
Okay, so the five-year thing I kind of dumped in on your story was for purpose. Yeah. So typically speaking, that keep in mind when you write a song, you own the song, you own the copyright of the song.
At that moment in time, right.
Right. A copyright is already born. Purpose of registration obviously does more things, like giving you that rebuttable presumption of ownership, as long as you do it in a timely manner. So if I do go sailing for 5 years, right, then I might lose that opportunity for the rebuttable presumption of ownership. It doesn't mean that I still cannot register it, but having that as an advantage, obviously, someone else coming along and saying it's theirs, well, they're gonna like, the burden of proof is on you, not on me. So that's obviously an advantage, right? To register in a timely manner. So that's number one. Number two is it gives me the rights to sue in a court of law. If you do not actually register your copyright, you cannot sue in a court of law, right? So you have to register in order to be able to sue. A lot of people don't know that, but how else are you going to protect your song? So it makes it easier to sue somebody when you register your compositions in a timely manner, obviously. And then third, you get what's called actual or statutory damages. That basically means that if you register your song before somebody rips you off, okay? So if you are sailing somewhere, having a good time, and someone rips you off, you're gonna lose the possibility of what's called actual or statutory damages. Actual or statutory damages basically means that you have to prove the actual damage with receipts and where things were shipped and copied and things like that, or you get statutory damages. In other words, a judge can hand down an infringement of anywhere from $750,000 to $150,000 per case of infringement without needing all of that, you know, receipts and things of that nature. Now, most lawyers won't represent you unless you have actual or statutory damages. So how do you know when someone's going to rip you off? You don't, right? So the earlier you register your songs and not go sailing, the better, right? So now there's all kinds of different ways to register your compositions, because when you're young and basically you're trying to support yourself and you're eating Top Ramen, which we've all done, right? $65 or $85 or whatever, you know, there's all different types of pricing depending on how you do it, is a lot of money. So somebody might say, well, God, I don't want to register these 10 songs because it's going to cost $65, and $65 times 10 is $650. And with $650, I can do so much stuff. So you know what? I'm not really going to worry about it. I'm just going to go ahead and put that thing out there, and I'm not going to worry about, you know, registration. I personally don't think that's a good idea. You know, I mean, as we both just discussed, there are benefits to copyright registration, and the earlier you do it, the better. So you should take advantage of registration, and you should take advantages of some of the new ways that you can register too. There's what's called a group of unpublished works. So as long as the authors are consistent on the 10 songs that you're trying to register, you can register 10 songs for $85, right? Which is great, as opposed to doing 10 songs for individually for $65, let's just say. There's also what's called the group registration for published works on an album. So that means basically if you've already published your works, but they're all part of an album, let's just say you're waterfalling and you're releasing singles one at a time, and then all of a sudden you're like, oh crap, I just heard this podcast with Bobby Borg and Michael, you know, and you know, they said that you need to register, so can I still go back and register those songs? You can, as long as they're all part of an album. And that's called group registration for published works on an album, and it's $65 for 20 songs. Groups of unpublished works, that's where like you write a big collection of works and you might be worried that the producer and some of the other people might rip you off. So you go and you do a group registration just to be safe. And then later on, when you release those songs individually, you could go back and register them as published works if you wanted to, right? So it benefits you to do this. I mean, like, why not? Right? I mean, it's not that much money. You guys spend so much money on your recording gear. You spend so much money on, like, you know, like your freaking coffees while you're writing your songs. You know, you'll go get a $10 coffee. You'll go buy laptops for $2,000. You'll go buy all the software, all the mics. You'll spend all your time learning. You'll record stuff. And then when it comes to registering the copyright, you don't want to do it. You want to find, you know, ways around that, you know.
Yeah, my friend Bobby was in the room with the when I wrote it, so he'll tell the judge that I created it on Christmas Eve, 2023. So this brings me to an obvious topic that you're probably going to get to, but I feel like it's time right now, which is the poor man's copyright. Every single musician on the planet has heard what we call in Yiddish a bubby meinze, which basically means an old grandmother's tale. That you can stick it in an envelope, print it onto a CD, put it on, you know, a chip, whatever, a thumb drive, stick it in an envelope, seal it up nice and tight, send it to yourself, registered mail, return receipt requested. You get that baby back in the mail a day later, you stick it in your safe, and 5 years later, somebody rips off your song and you go, but Your Honor, look, I've got this thing that's postmarked for Christmas Eve of 2023. I actually had a very famous music attorney that we both know, really, like, written the book on music law. And he did,
who that is.
Yeah, he did once say to me in an interview back in the mid-90s, it's better than having nothing. Mm-hmm. But you need to have it. It's not going to hold up, is the bottom line. You got to have it registered with the Copyright Office via the Library of Congress.
Yeah. So basically, I mean, the Copyright Office says on their website, you know, I mean, I could try to do the verbatim. I'll do the best I possibly can. Okay. But they said, please note that there is no such thing as a poor man's copyright. Or I should say, if I'm going to try to quote or paraphrase, it's like the Copyright Office does not recognize the act of a poor man's copyright. A poor man's copyright does not give you the three benefits of registration with the Copyright Office of Washington, D.C., which was a rebuttable presumption of ownership, the rights to file a lawsuit, and the rights to actual or statutory damages. I mean, it does not give you those three things. So what does a poor man's copyright give you? A judge might go, how did that CD or thumb drive get into a sealed envelope that was stamped by the U.S. government? And they might decide to allow that maybe partially as evidence with regards to like the date that it was written, but still it doesn't give you the rights to sue. It doesn't give you the rebuttable presumption of ownership. It doesn't give you actual statutory damages. So in essence, it doesn't do anything. So yes.
Right. Other than the judge saying, okay, I believe you did it on Christmas Eve 2023, right, but you don't have the rights, so that's a worthless get for
me. So as the person that you were referring to said, it is better than nothing, but it isn't good enough, right?
Yeah. What about so these companies that offer, there are like third-party companies out there, a couple of which I've known over the years that are run by very legitimate people, that you basically send them your song, you know, a digital file of your song online through a website or an app on a specific date, and you've got proof. It's kind of like a poor man's copyright, but I'm guessing it doesn't give you the benefits that registering a copyright
Yeah, some do and some don't. So we have to know the difference. There's one company in particular, and you know, we're not endorsing, so we don't necessarily have to name them, but there is one company that basically is an agent. So in other words, it's like somebody is listening right now and they're like, oh God, this stuff sounds so complicated and I just want to be a musician. Can't mm-hmm. someone else do this for me? So there is an agent that basically will say, yeah, we'll do it for you because we know this is a pain in the butt. So what you're doing is you're paying the agent plus what the copyright registration office wants. So you're paying more by getting the agent and you let them do it, right? So they're still doing it through the copyright office, but they're just doing it for you, right? And then there's other companies which are basically just timestamping, you know, your song in some sort of database to say, yeah, we're sort of a third party person over here and we have this registered in our database that this song on this date kind of thing, but it's not copyright registration. And in fact, interestingly enough, if you look on their websites themselves, they'll say in really small print, notice, this is not the same thing as copyright registration with the Copyright Office of Washington, D.C. and does not provide the same benefits as copyright registration. So you'll get it for like $5. Listen, SongGuard, okay? SongGuard is just timestamping it somewhere in a database. It's not copyright registration. So for
$5, it gives you the same rights or the same lack of rights as poor man's copyright.
No better.
It's a digital version of it. Yeah. Okay.
And then basically, it's SongGuard, I believe it is. And then the other one is CoSend. CoSend is the agent. So CoSend is a reputable company. A lot of people use them. They're just third party. They're doing it for you. And then SongGuard, I think it's called, is just they pay a $5 fee. It's a digital poor man's copyright, essentially.
Yeah, and you can make the argument for $5. Why not? It's one more thing to substantiate a claim, but it doesn't give you that specific set of rights. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, you can't even file a lawsuit unless you're registered. So, like, you know, it's almost like, it does something, but it's not enough.
Right.
Right. All right. So then, moving on. So you might say, okay, great, I'm protected. Awesome. Let's go to work. Let's like start syncing music. Let's start, you know, signing up for like taxi and like submitting listings and all this kind of stuff. I'm ready to rock and roll, right? Everything is cool. I'm protected. No. And you might go, what? You go, no. Well, think about it. How many times have you driven 35 in a 25? Okay. Probably lots of times. How many times have you smoked a cigarette where there's a sign behind you that says no smoking? How many times have you had a drink before age 21? In other words, my point is there will be laws in place, but laws can be broken. Mm-hmm. So keep in mind that because you registered your copyright, it doesn't stop anybody from stealing your song. It just makes it easier for you to sue them when they do use your song. And it might also be a deterrence. So in other words, if you look at my book and you open the page and you go copyright, you know, 2024, and it says, you know, Bobby Borg, you know, United States Copyright Office, it kind of looks scary and you're like, oh boy, I better think twice before I mess with this guy. So it could serve as like sort of a deterrent, right? Mm-hmm. But it really generally makes it easier for me to sue somebody that uses it without my permission, knowledge, or payment. So let's talk about copyright infringement really quick. Copyright infringement exists when someone uses your music without your permission, knowledge, or payment. Now, the most important thing is the damage. So if I'm in a band with Michael and Michael and I get into an argument and Michael's like, screw you, you know, and they, you know, goes off and plays at the Whiskey and they sell like 3D CDs and I wrote the song, but they take my name off of it because like he's a jerk and like he's an idiot and all that kind of stuff. And then I find out about it, right? Well, so basically that's three records maybe. If I go to a lawyer and I ask the lawyer to write a letter to tell them to stop, you know, selling the CDs, I'm gonna pay more to the lawyer than I'm actually owed for those three records that were sold. So right. There becomes an issue of, you know, is it substantial? Like, what's the damage? Is it worth going through all the headache? But when you're sitting in a movie theater and all of a sudden maybe a producer that you worked with is like doing the music supervision or somehow involved in like the film, and then all of a sudden you hear like your song and you're like, what, you know, then now there might be like some sort of more substantial damage here. And you know, you might, because it's very expensive to go through a lawsuit, but you might start to proceed in legal action. So what are some of the things that you need to kind of prove? Well, first, you know, that your music predates theirs. You used, you know, you wrote it before they, let's just say, for example, used it. It's, you know, you registered the copyright. They had what's called proving access. So in other words, they had access to stealing it. It could be that you worked on a session together. It could be that your music was already released and they had access to hearing it on Spotify. Could be a lot of different reasons, but it's substantially similar. It is unique in character, which basically means that it's not something that is common to all kinds of other songs. You might even go, in some cases, there might be even an issue where you have somebody that comes in as a witness. I was there when he wrote it. The song was written about me, blah, 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 et cetera, et cetera. There's a lot of factors that are involved here.
That would be a courtroom full of Taylor Swift's ex-boyfriends.
Yeah, exactly right. Yeah. Good, that's good. That's a good one. But, you know, but definitely speaking, I want you guys to all know that when you hear of, like, you know, lawsuits, like with Ed Sheeran's versus the Marvin Gaye's estates, you're talking about, like, a lot of money that's being put on the line here. So the average person can't afford to fight these types of lawsuits.
Nor will an attorney take it on the if-com on a contingency basis, unless it's somebody with very deep pockets.
Yeah, and absolutely, for sure. So typically, a lot of the times, these things get settled out of court. And it's just, you know, people either do like arbitration or mediation. They get together and they decide on something. And then there's might be a gag order that you're not allowed to talk about it and not allowed to talk about the different rates and things like that. But, you know, you have to be very, very careful because you could accidentally infringe somebody, you know. So if you're sitting at home and you're like, this sounds like a hit, it might actually be a hit, somebody else's, right?
So yeah, so you didn't do it by intent. You right. did it by osmosis because you've heard their hit 1,000 times.
Right. But it's still copyright infringement. So you have to be careful. You can't say I didn't know it was by accident. You can say that actually, but so you might not get sued for, you know, for it being willful. You know, it could be an accident, but still it's an infringement. So you have to be careful. Now, where are the areas of infringement most common? Usually in the areas of sampling or interpolations. So sampling is where you lift a part of a record and you use that in your record to enhance, like, you know, a background or something like that. Sometimes people think that you can do that. You can put it under the track, turn it upside down, put like reverb on it or something. You cannot, right? And then an interpolation is where you don't sort of pick a piece off of a record and you just replay a certain part. So that, you know, so you create your own master of it and you kind of bury it in the track and that kind of thing. And both
I want to spend a minute on that one because I don't know about this. So an interpolation, I take the riff from the song, Rolling Stone song, Satisfaction, bom, bom, ba-da-da, and I don't lift it from their record and use it in my hip hop record, but I sit down and play that riff. And then use my version I recorded. That's against the law as well.
Because I mean, basically, you're now infringing the authors and owners of the song. In the first example, the sampling, you're infringing the authors and owners of the sound recording and the authors and owners of the song, right? So it makes it it makes it simpler, maybe, because now you only have to deal with one person, but it's still an infringement unless you get that. Obviously, you get that licensed. Okay, you guys. So this is an area where, believe it or not, there's going to be a lot of people that are going to want to argue this. And I've gotten into like arguments with younger folks because they're like, well, there's a whole generation of people that do that. They sit in the bedrooms and they, you know, it's like an art form and, you know, DJs do that and stuff like that. I'm like, and I'm going, you guys, I don't care what you do. I mean, I do care what you do. And I do care that it's an art form. And I do care that it's a thing. And I do care that it's a vibe and it's a culture and all that kind of stuff. But it's a culture, unfortunately, based on infringement, you know, and you have to get things cleared. And the problem is, obviously, is that me and you, Michael, saw the world before computers, and we saw the world before social media. And it wasn't that long ago, you guys. You might laugh and go, ha ha, these guys are old guys. It was basically 1992 when I believe the internet became commercial, before it was being used for the military. And then 1990, you know, I mean, I remember the world without like Pro Tools, you know, I mean, you know, so all of this is we get it maybe, and maybe the younger generation that was born in 2002 or something like that, or three, you know, they basically everything is free on the internet, you know? So it feels like the government is just like the man that's trying to stop you, and copyright law is evil. But let's investigate this real quick. Copyright law was put into place to make what we're doing right now worth doing. Because if there was no incentive to be artists, if any one of you guys, Michael and I are way more connected than you, we have way more experience than, let's just say, for example, some of you, right? Because some of you are obviously our age as well. But just imagine if you took something, and then because we have more connections, we took yours and then all of a sudden used it without paying you, without you knowing about it, let's just say. And would that be cool? And then we're earning money on it and you're not? Like, how would you be able to survive? Like, you would, I mean, if you wanted to quit your day job and do this full time, how would you be able to do that if everybody could always rip you off? So one thing you have to understand is that copyright law was put into place to give an incentive to you and I to actually do this. And they gave us what's called a limited duration monopoly. That means we have the monopoly on the ownership of the song for our full life plus 70 years. They've given us a lot of time to incentivize us to do this. Otherwise, who the hell in their right mind would do this? If I wrote this book and I'm like, hey, you guys, I wrote this book, and they're like, cool, let's go Xerox it, make a bunch of copies, put covers on it, and like start selling it to everybody. What? Why would in my right mind would I go, let me go do another one now?
Right.
I mean, it would just be like, so make no mistake, I do this for the love, for the art, you know, for sharing, for giving something back, and all of that stuff. Yes. But of course, I'm also a business person, and I'm not going to pretend that I just do it because I'm the Pied Piper of music business, right? And Michael has a business. He does it first and foremost from his heart. And that's basically why we're able to be successful at certain endeavors, because when you do things from the heart and when you care about people, that does make a big difference on your brand. But you know, you can't tell that to the light company or to the office space you're renting. Hey, you guys, I do this for the art. You should do it for the art too. The world doesn't work that way. That's not how our system of economics has been built, you know? So, you know, you have to get paid. And there's nothing to be ashamed about when, you know, you wanting to get paid. So
here's the irony.
Respect copyright laws.
You went right where I was thinking, which is the same person who might freely rip somebody off on a lick, like, you know, the guitar lick from Satisfaction, and use that and feel like, well, I'm entitled, especially because I didn't even take it from their record. I just played it. That person would also very likely be quick to sue somebody else who infringed them. So there's this duplicitous attitude about it, I think.
There really is, unfortunately. And I don't think it's until that you're actually writing a lot of stuff and you're getting ripped off left and right that you'll start to really go, oh, I see, I get it now. I mean, it's crazy. I kind of tell the joke about this. Listen, I know some people are struggling, but I literally have some people that take my class on music publishing, and they are asked to, hey, you guys, you know, we're going to use this book in the class. And what they do instead is go online and find an illegal downloaded version of the book.
Wow.
To take a class from the person that wrote the book on how to protect yourself from copyright and music publishing. And I'm just going, yeah, I mean, like, I'm like going, are you guys, I mean, like, I'm going, seriously, like, think about this. I mean, and so you have to respect the laws that are also going to protect you as well. So the laws serve you, but you also have to serve the laws as well, right? So it's very, very important. All right, let's just move on really quickly. Everything we just talked about also applies to sound recordings as well.
Right.
And what's one of the things that people don't understand is that a song. I mean, what is a song? Hang on a second. Here's my song floating around. You see it, right? So a lot of times when you look at when you think of a song, you think of the recording of the song, the file of the song. That's the song, right? No, the song is. That's the song. The file of the song is the sound recording, right? And they're two different copyrights. So the owners of a song can be different than the owners of the sound recording. And sometimes they can be the same. So they're the same when you're a DIY artist and you write a song and then you record the song. You basically own the song and the master of the song. And that's to an advantage when you're licensing in film and television, simply because now you're called the one-stop shop. It's really easy to actually license it to people that want to use it because you're able to negotiate both sides, right? And usually when you get paid, you're paid all in, meaning the
covers one side, both sides, yeah. The recording, exactly. And the composition.
And they're done in a most favored nation's basis. So the master gets 500, the song gets 500, you get 1,000, which is covering both ends, right? So they're kind of bringing all the facts together now, right? Now, but in some cases, when you get signed to a record company, the record company in a contract is going to say that they own the master recording, right? So if you remember earlier when sort of Michael was talking about covers and things like that, he kind of said, you know, you write the song, but the record company might own the master. That's what he was essentially referring to. That's very typical. Now, what happens when you record a song and a producer comes into the project, right? So now a producer is helping you capture that sound on a record. They're participating in that. You have musicians that are coming in and they're putting their performance of your song on a record. Now, these are also master owners as well, unless this is for the $1 million question and the trip to Hawaii, you have a
copyright.
Work made for hire.
Oh, right? Work for hire. Okay. Right? Yeah.
Work made for hire agreement in place, which basically says that, you know, the drummer coming in to play drums is not going to own the performance of his song on record.
Maybe the most classic case of this, and I'm doing this from memory. I could be wrong, but I think I'm right, and you may know if I'm right or wrong in this. Do You Think I'm Sexy by Rod Stewart. I happened to be vacuuming the carpet at Criteria Studios in Miami in the year that was recorded. There were two 55-ish looking guys playing pinball in the lobby, and I'm vacuuming, and through the wall I hear, wah, 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 wah. I interrupted those guys who were Tom Dowd and Arif Martin making Do You Think I'm Sexy with Rod Stewart. The keyboard player, I'm doing this from memory from 40-some years ago, was a guy named Dwayne Hitchings. And he came up with that riff. I'm doing this, I could be wrong, but I think I'm right. He did that riff many years later, filed a lawsuit saying I had substantial input in that song's creation and success, because without wah, 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 da, 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 da.
Yeah.
So I think he might have won that lawsuit, and this is exactly what you're talking about. Because if he'd signed if he signed a work for hire, they'd go, sorry, dude, you got paid to play, and you've got no claim. But if he wasn't asked to sign a work for hire, there you go.
Yeah. And then, of course, and that's on the composition side. Of course, then when they play on the record, then they can claim that they own the performance on the record as well. So they'd be an owner in the actual sound recording.
Wow.
So you want to make sure to have a work made for hire agreement on that too. So any of you guys out there that write and then have people come play on your record, you think it's like, oh yeah, come on over, play a guitar solo on my record. Be careful, because they could claim that they own the sound recording.
And not just a record, we're talking sync as well, which is the general underlying theme of today's topic, because that's very, very common. I need a sax part, and I reach out to another taxi member who happens to be great at sax, and puts it down if I don't get a work for hire, which is just a very simple agreement that says, I played saxophone on this song on this date for X amount of dollars, and I have no future claims as to the creation of the song. I was only paid to play the saxophone. That's it, right? Mm-hmm. It's not like a 30-page contract.
Well, the problem being is that if you do then license your song in sync, keep in mind that you are licensing both the sound recording and the song. So if you have a saxophone player that played on the sound recording and then hears his music in a television show. And he's like, wait, what the hell? That's me playing in a television show. And all I got was that measly Coke and a smile, you know, on the session, right? Basically, you owe me money. And then that becomes problematic. So yeah, you need to make sure to have all your musicians sign off that they are not have any ownership claim in the actual master.
And do it at the beginning of the session, because people may change their perception of their contribution may actually change during the during that session. By the time they wrap it up, they go, wow, I really did a lot. No, I don't want to sign that agreement. But if you get it in the beginning, there you go. And from what I've heard from our members, it's not a very adversarial, some people have said, oh yeah, but putting paper under somebody's nose, asking them to sign it before they play on my session, creates kind of an uncomfortable moment and I may not get a great performance from them. To which I say, I have never heard of one case in 32 years of running Taxi where a member had anybody walk out of a session refusing to sign the work for hire. And it may be uncomfortable for 15 seconds. That's as bad as it gets.
I think it's uncomfortable for people when they're sort of just starting out, but mm-hmm. this is pretty common, you guys, in the business. I mean, even so much to the point where I hear professionals say, hey, John, what's going on? Hey, everything's cool. Well, listen, I'm working on this song for a Mercedes commercial. I've got about 90% of it written. I need a little bit of help on the bridge. You know, I'll cut you in 10%. You want to come over? You know, I've heard stuff like that, and no one has any problem with that kind of conversation. You know, it's professional talk. You know, you get kind of used to it. But in the early stages of your career, when you're just trying to be hip and cool and fit in, you know, people might be uncomfortable with it. But, you know, the good news is you could just blame it on us. You could say, I heard this podcast. It's their fault. They told me to be businesslike. You know, you just want to make sure that you get all this stuff cleared, or it could come back and bite you in the you know what. So just want to make sure that everything is together.
I want to bring up another topic that goes along with all this, obviously, which is Taxi members finally have that dream come true. Their music is forwarded. It lands on somebody's desk, sends them an email or a phone call, says, this is great. I'd like to include it in my catalog. And the member looks at the deal and it says that the production music library gets 100% of the publisher share. We should start out, actually happen to have my wallet nearby. So I am going to pull a pretend this is...
You're going to rip it?
No, I'm not. It's a $10 bill. Pretend this is a $1 bill. If I were to rip this down the middle, there is the publisher share and then there is the writer share. And together they make 100%, but there is also 100% of the publisher share and 100% of the writer share. That's where people get confused. So let's say that the library, Michael's Music Library, offers Bobby a deal on his instrumental track called New Orleans Nights, and the contract is exclusive, meaning only my company gets to represent it, and it asks for 100% of the publisher share, but you, Bobby, gets to keep 100% of the writer shares. So if I make a buck, you make a buck, and I'm not talking sync fees, which is the upfront payment. Right now I'm talking performance money that comes through your PRO on the back end. So many people, literally countless people over the years have pissed off these libraries because they call them up and offer them that deal. And it will say that in the listing. If you don't like the deal that's spelled out in the listing, don't submit. But people still do. And then they say, I took a music law course in college and the professor said, hold on to your publishing. Or I ran this by my music attorney, who is my uncle Gino, who is a real estate attorney in Poughkeepsie, but he actually took a music law course in college in 1974 because he just loves music. And Uncle Gino is saying, don't give up your publishing. Educate the masses, please.
Yeah, so essentially, so where do we start? There's a lot of stuff here to unravel, but I'll just try to keep it real quick.
Well, let's start with that's a normal thing in the world of music licensing for independents. Right. Okay.
Very normal. I mean, that's a normal deal. So when you write a song, when you create a song, and now we're moving into the world of publishing and the monies that you receive. the monies are divided into two separate and equal shares, the writer's share and the publisher's share. If you're looking at the 100% pie, then writer's share represents 50% of the money that comes in, and the publisher's share represents the other 50%, just as Michael said. If you look at like each part individually, then there's 100% of the writers and 100% of the publishers, just like Michael just said, right? But I just want to be really, really clear that you own both those rights until you sign those rights over to somebody else. Mm-hmm. So in other words, when you write a song, you are the writer and you are the publisher. I know the writer part is easy because you're like, yeah, I wrote it, but who's this publishing guy? You know, it's you. Until you give the rights over to somebody else to publish your music. Now, why would you do that? Because they probably do it better than you, meaning they have access to plugging your songs that you don't. Hence, this particular agreement that you're looking at and you're freaking out about, right? Why are you even looking at it in the first place? Because you can maybe not find the same opportunities that they are finding, the relationships that they have over the years that they've created, their ability to understand how to collect the money, how to license the money, how to negotiate for the money, and so on and so forth. These are all the reasons why you might even entertain this type of deal in the first place, okay? Now, essentially, the publisher is responsible for, you know, the business side, and they actually are going to collect all of the money except for the public performance writer share, which goes directly to you, but they collect
well most through your PRO. Yeah.
Uh-huh, right. They collect most of the money except for that one exception. Right. And then they turn around and they say, okay, we take 50% of that, which is the publisher share of the money. And then basically you will get the other 50% of that money, which is the writer's percent share of the money. And that is a very, very common deal. And then typically in those situations, it's exclusive, meaning that they don't want two people pitching it at the same time because, you know, I could call and say, hey, you should use this song. And then Michael calls and says, hey, you should use this song. And it kind of looks silly, you know, like we're stepping on each other's feet. So some people will say, we are going to exclusively seek out placements for you for a period of a year or 2 years or 3 years or whatever the term is, and you can't, you know, do it. No one else can do it. They might say that it's fine if you sell it at your shows and it's fine if you do this or that. There might be some exceptions, but generally for the purpose of sync, they might say only we can do it, right? Mm-hmm. And that's a very, very common deal. You know, if you're going to get into this business, then you should pretty much, you know, understand this because you're going to see it a lot. And it's really not anything to freak out about. You just have to try to decide, is it worth giving somebody 50% of the money in return for what I'm getting, which is the exposure, which is, you know, I mean, it's like the old saying, you know, half a loaf of bread is better than none. You know, yeah.
Or 100, owning 100% of the publishing is something that never gets exploited and earns a penny. Great. You go to your grave owning 100% of nothing.
Exactly. And to really kind of answer your question very, very specifically, which is, you know, all of the people that freak out about don't sign your publishing or don't give your publishing away. The world is full of opportunity cost. I mean, we just said it, you know, it's like, what's the cost of the opportunity? Well, you're giving up 50% of your money. So what are you getting back in return? And does that balance out, right? And sometimes, especially in the beginning of your career, you know, you shouldn't be thinking about that. You should be thinking about the exposure, the experience, and that type of thing. Maybe later on, the deals maybe could be differently, but this is a pretty common deal, you guys.
It's extremely common. But yeah, you know what? Let's differentiate because the topic of today's show is, in fact, music publishing for sync music creators. So in sync, this is a very common deal. Now, however, and you alluded to this 40 minutes ago, probably, if I've written a song and that song, it sounds like a hit. Everybody in the business hears it, goes, dude, that song is going to get cut by some major artist. It could be a number one Billboard single. On that thing, treat it differently. than a song you wrote for sync that really has zero potential of being a hit for anybody. Its only purpose in life is to end up in a TV show and make you a few hundred or a couple thousand dollars down the road. So just know that it is true. Don't be so quick to give up your publishing if you've written your grand opus and your desire for the grand opus is to pitch it to Beyonce or whomever. That's a different kettle of fish. Am I correct in saying
absolutely.
That?
Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, yeah, especially if it's an exclusive deal where they're saying like only we can pitch it, that might mean that if this is like your baby and this is your hit that you're like hoping to like change your life and your career, you know, you're going to want to have some control of what you can do with that music as well. But also moving into the area of publishing deals, because mm-hmm. these are like licensing sort of one-off type SOG plugging sync kind of stuff. But if you're going into the publishing deal world, where you're signing contracts with Universal Music Publishing, you know, and Warner Chappell, et cetera, a lot of times, you know, that saying also applies, like don't give up your publishing or be careful about signing away your publishing. But also, just to be clear, that typically speaking, when you sign a contract with the music publishing company, they do want you to sign over the ownership of the music publishing rights to them under the terms of an agreement, simply because they want to be able to collect, they want to be able to license it easily, right? And the fact that they own it makes them licensing it easier, collecting the money becomes easier. They want to get their advances back, so they want to own it to make sure that that happens. So in these areas, you have to also be particularly careful, because in some deals, you might sign away your rights for LOC. And that basically means the life of copyright, which basically means that now they control your copyright for the full life of copyright.
So with LOC, also the word perpetuity, people always ask, what does that mean? Sure. Same thing?
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah. I mean, you know, they're going to own it for forever. But of course, the copyright term is not forever in duration, because it will expire at some point, right?
Right.
We talked about the duration of copyright. So that's where maybe those two terms would be different. Because in perpetuity is forever, but you know, copyright duration is not forever. But so maybe you could say forever of the duration, right? But in any case, so you want to have your attorneys negotiate what's called reversion of copyright. And reversion of copyright is basically where your rights will revert back to you after some point in the future, after the expiration of your music publishing deal. So the rights revert back to you. So let's just say there can be different types of reversion. So after the advance is recouped and after 10 years, after the term of the deal expires, those rights come back to you, which are beneficial because now you have full control of licensing and you can get a new publishing deal and you can sell your catalog like so many people are doing. If you don't own them, you can't sell them, right? So when you do a big publishing deal like that, you want to make sure that there's some sort of reversionary clause in there, particularly. And that's where you hear the horror stories of like where the Beatles basically like signed away, like in an exclusive songwriters agreement, they signed away their music publishing rights, which basically means someone else owns the copyright and they get 50% of the money and someone else gets 50% of the money. So if $1 million comes in for the Beatles, someone's getting $500,000 of it. And what's really the worst part about that is the person getting the $500,000 did nothing, because right. The Beatles basically catalog basically draws people in and of itself. So that's the horror, right? And then we also hear the horrible stories about like how Michael Jackson gets together with Paul McCartney. And Paul McCartney goes, I'm like buying copyrights. And Michael Jackson's like, really? Are you? And then Michael Jackson ends up buying his copyrights. and of course, they weren't friends after that. But what happened in that situation is the Beatles signed a deal with the music publishing company. And then that music publishing company sold the contract to, and made it available for sale under the terms of the original agreement. So you can do that. You can transfer the original contract. And Michael Jackson outbid Paul McCartney for buying those rights back. So those are the horror stories that you hear. Then there's another horror story where a guy named Richard Berry, you know, wrote a song called Louie, Louie, ta-ta, whoa, whoa, right? And he signed the publishing rights away for like $500 or something like that. And then the song explodes and blow ups, and it's being licensed here and here and here and here. And he doesn't control it. He's still getting some money from it, but he
from
doesn't.
From the writer's share.
Right, doesn't own and control it. So then finally, after something called the United States Termination of Rights, the 35-year right of termination law, which basically says under all terms of any publishing agreement you sign, you have a chance at getting your rights back after 35 years if you do like ABC. It's kind of complicated, the ABC, but you can get your rights back. Finally, 35 years later, he gets his rights back and then dies a year later. You know, I mean, that those are the horror stories that we hear that like freak us out. But you guys, you can sit at home with your copyrights and own 100% all you want. And you can like sit at home and not do the deals because you're afraid everybody's out to rip you off. And then do nothing, you know? So I say this caution, you know, do something, you know, but just be careful of what you're doing. Watch this podcast, you know, read books, educate yourself. But not everybody is out to rip you off. I mean, you can't think like that, or you're just going to be frozen into doing nothing.
But that's one of those old myths that has persisted for decades with musicians, is that everybody in the music industry is out to rip me off. And while that may have been true, I mean, frankly, a lot of like, you know, African-American soul groups in the 50s and 60s did get ripped off by label owners or publishers that had the intent to rip them off. On the sync side of thing in today's industry, I have not met one production music library president, owner, CEO, nor have I met any musicians that have ever been ripped off. The sync part of the industry, there's not enough money, generally speaking. There are always exceptions, like, you know, a famous song being used in an Apple commercial would generate a lot of money for the creators. Most of the time, it's nickels, dimes, and dollars, and nobody's going to go to the trouble of ripping you off for that. And if they're not deep pockets involved, the lawsuits never get brought. So I think that that is words for the, from the wise for the wise, that don't take those old examples and things that have become mythical and persisted for decades and apply those to the sync industry of today, because they are two different animals.
Yeah. And you started, you know, this presentation today, you started actually with the myth of everybody thinks that, you know, the major labels are out to rip you off, and, you know, the deals are like so lopsided, and don't sign with a major label, and, you know, it's all over TikTok, you know, F the man, do it yourself, I don't need anybody, you know, all that. But let's talk about that just for a second, because it ties into the same philosophy of the publishing, the big monster publishing deal kind of thing. So just kind of trailing off the publishing thing, first of all, keep in mind, you guys, that publishing has evolved quite a lot. There's a lot more people that are smart out there. There's a lot more, there's literally schools you can go to. I teach at them, where you get degrees in music business. I mean, when the hell did that exist? You know, this is all, I think Berklee College of Music's program started in 1999 or 2000. So like, what was the industry before that? People didn't understand the industry. Now there's like, there used to be exclusive singer-songwriter agreements where, you know, you were signing over essentially 50% of the ownership in your money. Now the most common deal is a co-publishing agreement, where you're signing away, you know, maybe 25% of your money. So you're getting 75, they're getting 25 for providing all these services to you. And in some cases, if there's enough money to collect, you can own everything and just pay them a 50% fee under an administration agreement, you know? So things have evolved incredibly. Now, as far as the record deal thing goes, let's look at that real quick, because this is something that a lot of people don't talk about. A lot of people talk about, the record company like owns your masters, and then they get like, you know, 85% of the sales and streams, and you only get 15%. And after they do all these ridiculous calculations, you might like get like this little amount of money. We're just talking about the record companies, not Spotify and all that stuff right now. We're just talking about the record companies. And that is true. The deals are just first look, maybe lopsided, but you guys are forgetting something here, right? If you release a record and the record company invests, let's just say, for example, $500,000 or $1 million into recording and promotion and all that kind of stuff, and the record fails, the record company is out $1 million. You are out nothing. And you might be like, what? But I thought you owe them. You owe them only in sales and streams. That's how you're paying them back. You're paying them back when your record sells or streams, or when your record is licensed. They're taking that money and they're using that to recoup, right? But you don't have to take it out of your pocket, but it came out of their pocket. Now, let's just say the record company wasn't involved and you went out and you took your inheritance money of $1 million, right? And you release a record and it fails. Well, now there's two sucks. Number one, you didn't make it. Number two, you're out $1 million. So in the first case scenario, it sucks that you didn't make it, but you're not out $1 million. So just keep that in mind. I mean, the record companies are taking huge risks, and that's why the deals are lopsided, because the stiffs, right? There's a lot of stiffs, and really it's destined to be a stiff, unfortunately, statistically, mm-hmm. right? So the hits pay for the stiffs. The one record that actually does succeed because of the deals is able to pay back all of the others. Now, you guys might feel that's not fair. I just want you guys to know who you're talking to. Someone that was signed to a major label, someone that actually was signed to independent labels, and someone that did it themselves. So if anyone could be bitching, it could be me. And you guys see that I'm not. I'm thinking objectively. When record companies want to be your friends and they want to do, and they do what they say they're going to do, they can blow up your career. They have the resources to do it. They have the bootstraps in China and Australia and England, all over the country, doing what potentially you can't do on your own, because you just don't have the manpower to
do it. You don't have the time or the intellectual, not intellectual wherewithal. You don't have the education. You don't have the mech. It'd be like trying to run for president without that organization that the DNC or the RNC puts behind a candidate.
Yeah. You also don't have the relationship. Sure, you can go to DistroKid and stuff. Do you really think that DistroKid has the same relationships with the DSPs as Universal Records does?
Right.
Not even, right? You're one in a million. I mean, I beg your pardon if I'm being foul, but you can basically like fart to a metronome and DistroKid will release it. Yeah. You know what I mean? It's just like they'll release anything. So you don't have the same relationships. You don't have the same access to getting into films and televisions and doing collabs. And also, you know, hey, my name is Bobby Borg, I'm signed to Universal Records, versus, hey, my name is Bobby Borg, I'm signed to Chair Carpet Records. So don't get me wrong. I wrote a book called DIY Music Marketing, right? So I'm a proponent of the whole DIY independent movement. But we have to look at things objectively, and everything serves a purpose. You know, doing it yourself is excellent. You control it. You have power. There's a lot of greatness involved. You can actually end up doing collaborations with people. You can do joint ventures. You can do partnerships with people. You know, you could build leverage. You know, but at some point you might decide that with all this leverage, now I'm going to use that power and leverage to negotiate maybe a better deal with someone that I would like to do business with.
Right.
So, you know, you just kind of have to think about all the different levels and steps and be objective about it.
It's funny. Over the years, people call Taxi a sync company, and probably 80% of what we do is sync related, but 20 or 30% on any given day are stars in the country market looking for a fresh new hit, or labels. We've got a very high level A&R person now affiliated with a major label running listings looking for new acts. And musicians have been saying for the last 20 years, don't ever sign a deal with a label. You don't need them. You can put your music out on the internet through DistroKid or CD Baby or whatever. Yes, you can, but you don't have any of the mechanism behind you that will probably... The chances of blowing up as a true independent without that machine working with you and behind you, really, really, really infinitesimally small chances of succeeding. Never say never, but it's like less than a 1% chance, probably.
So, yeah, just to be really clear, well, particularly you mean sustaining any blow up? Because I mean, you could go viral, let's just say, for example, on TikTok, but yeah. Like now what? Are you going to know what to do about that?
Right. If you don't have the machine in place to move immediately on that, if you take 30 days to get your act together, it's done. So all that said, funny enough, when we run listings where record labels are looking for stuff, we get a lot of submissions for those. So even though people verbalize, don't sign with a major, people still want to be signed to a major. And I think it's a good choice on their part because you need that machine behind you.
Listen, you know, I sometimes joke. I go, you know what, Michael? I'm never going to date a supermodel, man. Don't date supermodels. You know, it's just like ridiculous. I don't know anyone that will date a supermodel. You know, it's like, and then you're asked by a supermodel to date them, and you're like, yes, when? You know, where do we meet? You know, so it's kind of like a lot of the people that are saying don't sign with a major label or people that have never asked and are sometimes people that would never be in the position of being asked. And I don't mean to offend anybody with that, but I have seen so many artists that have jumped up and down on the whole independent kind of wagon. And then all of a sudden they get offered something and they come to me, can you look at the contract? Can you look at the contract? You know, and stuff like that. Or can you recommend an attorney? So look, here it's very, very simple. What are you giving up and what are you getting in return? And is that balanced and does it make sense? If it's not balanced and doesn't make sense, then don't do it. You know what I mean? It's that simple. Just don't do it. You know, that's, I think, ultimately the way you need to look at it.
We have actually gone over by about 3 minutes, believe it or not, on our time. This was incredible. And I'm really glad that we're doing this because a lot of people don't understand the basics of publishing and they learn it in a nonlinear way, largely word of mouth, and a lot of that word of mouth is incorrect. It's the old wives' tales and the myth. Bobby has written many, many books over the years. How many books do you have out there? Like 6 or 7 now?
Yeah, pretty much, right? Yeah. I look at these things and I just go, my God, did I actually write this? Yeah, I spend a lot of time. I dedicate a lot of time to this.
This book, I read the original. I haven't read the third edition of it, which literally just came out. But it covers so much. It's an incredibly comprehensive book for somebody that wants to understand all this stuff. Anything from management contracts to contracts with other band members, all the publishing stuff that we talked about today. And I'm looking at the back of the book and the fact that you've got Peter Paterno, you know, he's a top three music attorney in the industry that works with just the who's who. And Don Gorder, God, I haven't spoken to him in like 20 years. Incredible people talking about how much they love this book. But buy this book. I don't make a penny from it, you know. We're not going to sell 1,000 books on today's show, but if you don't really understand the business side of the sync industry, especially the publishing side of the sync industry, you're hurting yourself. You are taking money out of your pocket, lighting a match to it. And I wish you all lived locally so you could go take one of Bobby's classes at USC. I've been a guest speaker 2 or 3 times in his classes, and the whole time I'm sitting there thinking, do these kids have any idea how lucky they are to have somebody with this knowledge and this experience teach him? So I'm really grateful that you took time to join me today for Taxi TV and that you come every year for the Road Rally. And I look forward to being a guest at your class again whenever you need me.
Yeah, no, thank you so much, you guys. And just kind of like as a final word, I just kind of want to I want to kind of point out to you that, you know, of course, as Michael said, I'm a musician first and foremost, and I'm very fortunate. You know, I was one of those crazy guys that practiced 100 hours a day, and then, you know, just by sheer determination, you know, got some breaks and went out and toured and made records and was on MTV and was on the radio and in posters and in all those magazines and stuff like that. So, you know, I had an opportunity to say, wow, I fulfilled my dream. You know, I was on the tour buses. I did it. I toured, played in front of a lot of people and stuff. And I was grateful for that. But I felt there was a time in my life where I kind of needed to move on. And I became as passionate as I was about the music with the music business.
Yeah.
And particularly what I found was that there's a lot of information out there. A lot of it can be confusing. And I needed to kind of reorganize it in a way that kind of made sense to me and was simple and just like, let's take off all the fluff. Let's not go down the rabbit holes. Let's just kind of keep things simple. And wrote it in sort of that conversational style.
The books are very, very easy to digest.
Yeah. So, you know, you'll get a strong foundation from this, and certainly hope that you guys read this and then invite me and Michael to all your Grammy parties, right? make sure that we're on the list and, like, you know, share all your successes. But definitely that's the whole point, right? So that maybe your path could be obviously a little bit easier and you can sort of find your way through the obstacles a little bit easier.
Well, right? The Pied Piper of that. People should where your website, bobbyborg.com, B-O-R-G, bobbyborg.com?
Yeah, sure. You know, that's definitely, I mean, sort of like the, you know, the home base kind of thing, you know. But of course, these days, you know, from there, you'll find links to my TikTok and find links to my YouTube channel, youtube.com/bobbyborg, and, you know, my Instagram channel, et cetera. So yeah, that is the hub. So bobbyborg.com, to keep it simple. You guys can, you know, email me, and I send out, you know, email things for my YouTube videos that I release and stuff like that. So we can keep in touch that way if you choose to do that.
Definitely. And they should, you know, they can always take themselves off the list if they don't find what you're giving them to be valuable, you know. So
that's,
it's
right.
a no risk
yeah.
proposition. It's like, do you want a world-class education that USC pays you a lot of money to bring to those students and they can get it for free on all your social media and stuff? They should.
They can get lots of the bits and pieces, for sure. They can get a lot of stuff. I mean, we offer a lot of stuff, even this right here, right? This meeting ourselves, right, Michael?
Yep.
That's the way the world is. There's so much information out there. You guys should definitely take advantage of it, for sure.
Well, I'm really grateful that you showed up to do this with me today, and look forward to doing one with you again. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Bobby Borg.
Thank you, guys.
Bye-bye, Bobby.
Thank you.